Sure, I mean, I did a useless business studies degree in Edinburgh. Then my first job coming down to London immediately after that was to work at Virgin, and I stayed there for far too many years. And then I made the biggest mistake of my life, in as much as I left Virgin and moved into investment banking. And then from there I lucked out, I sold my business to a Wall Street bank so I could retire onto the beach and on the golf course. And something really sad happened, in as much as I got tempted to go and raise money for a project. People kept on approaching me to put my own money into projects, and they didn't know I was Scottish, so that was never going to happen. And I set about looking to raise money for other people. Yeah, sure. I mean, so that was 7 years ago, and 7 years ago I sort of I set about trying to raise money for a specific project, and I met people who pretended they had money. I met people who pretended they knew people who had money. I met people who pretended they could add value to my business plan or they could get me investment ready. And at the end of 6.5 months and many thousands of pounds, I walked away with nothing. Nothing. And I thought to myself, here I am as an accountant. I'm an investment banker. I'm Scottish, Rishi. I'm getting ripped off. What is it like for entrepreneurs out there who have no idea about how to raise money or the numbers, or aren't interested in the numbers, and really just want a fluid, transparent mechanism to raise as much money as quickly as possible? Sure. I mean, so we get 140 applications a day to join up, and what we do is we get rid of the Muppets, we get rid of people who write in crayons, or people who've got a new Facebook and Twitter and Yahoo and alternative, and we get rid of people who send me cupcakes, and we get down to whittle that down very quickly to about 20 odd people. We meet those 20 odd people, and the beautiful thing, which I must admit we didn't really appreciate, was that the marketplace is telling us what they want to invest in. So we see 140 people a day sending business plans, but we also have over 400 angels a day coming to the site. And we measure at the back end exactly what they're looking at, i.e. they tell us exactly what they're looking to invest in, and then even the fool like myself can set off and filter out the people who haven't got what they're looking for, to get down to maybe one, maybe two people a day who we allow through to pitch. The number one thing for any entrepreneur, any young entrepreneur, is the ability to be able to communicate what you do. So we meet, say, in London. We meet 20, 30 people a week, and 36% of people follow up the first question, which is, Rishi, great to meet you, dude. Tell me about your business. 36% of people fail to be able to communicate effectively. Give them 20 minutes, they're still rabbiting on. They still can't get across. So very good communication skills. They have to come across with passion. They have to totally be committed to what it is that they're looking to do. They have to have an understanding of it. Young entrepreneurs in particular believe they can do it all themselves. You say that, the big chute opens up and you find yourself outside the British Library, because no matter how good you are, there's nothing you can do these days on your own. You have to be able to understand what your weaknesses are, so you have to be able to have a collective team of people together who augment those differences. And then ideally, having communicated that, having actually worked out what it is that you need to do, having worked out especially what the team needs to do, it would be fantastic if you could actually prove the business model. So have you got one mug to buy what it is that you're trying to sell? Just one person? Or is it just your mum's going, this is a fantastic idea, and I think we should, you know, this is definitely going to work? External validation is almost essential in this marketplace. Okay. Yeah, and it's actually more difficult to look at investors. What we're looking for is a track record of having invested before. To join up, they have to be high net worth, so they'll have to have more than £100,000 of free capital, so not a house and whatever, or be a member of another angel network, or have made sort of 6 angel investments. But still, people can get through that who aren't necessarily motivated to invest and they want to then sell to an entrepreneur. And the beautiful thing about our model is that you can come along, you can pitch to an angel. If the angels don't invest after 3 meetings, we take them to one side. We say, dude, couldn't help notice that we've brought you the best deals in Manchester, Kuala Lumpur, Singapore, Hong Kong, wherever you happen to be in the world. You haven't invested. Tell me, what is it that you're keen to invest in? Because we've got 16,000 people in our database.
Yeah.
Almost every peccadillo is catered for. We will bring to you in a club, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, see you in Adam Street, we'll bring companies to you for you to have a look at. If they then don't invest, we just quietly take them off to one side. It doesn't happen that often, to be honest. 16,000 entrepreneurs, as I said, I'm actually on the platform, and that is balanced with 5,600 angels. And off those, you know, maybe 400 are active on a sort of daily basis, and 400 come to the site every day. And it's actually relatively straightforward because it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. If you keep the quality of your entrepreneurs up, angels keep on coming back.
Sure.
If you do put some Muppets in front of them or on the database, the angels have got better things to do. They have got better things to do with their time. So we keep the quality up, it keeps the number of angels coming back. Because we do so many deals, obviously the entrepreneurs keep them coming back. So it's almost a system. I think it was dead simple. So I was an accountant at Virgin, but I was possibly the worst accountant the world has ever seen. And just when you thought it couldn't get any worse, I moved into investment banking, where I think officially I was the worst investment banker in the world. Because on accountancy, on investment banking, you know, I'm not an attention to detail kind of guy. You know, I used to produce balance sheets that didn't balance. I just wasn't interested in the numbers, but I was really good with people. And so the problem that I diagnosed, the disease that I had, was entrepreneurship. And it's almost oxymoronic to be an entrepreneurial accountant. I didn't know what it was, I just thought I was rubbish.
Yeah.
I didn't know why I was so bad, but I always wanted to change the way that the accounting was done.
Yeah.
I always wanted to add value to it. I wanted to do investment banking in a slightly different way, in a kind of wacky way, using social media or doing whatever. And people were just staring at me like I had 17 heads. I just didn't get it.
Yeah.
And until I then started hanging out with some... It then sort of just clicked. It just clicked that actually I could add value on my own. I was also fed up making money for other people,
yeah.
Who were taking the vast majority, and I kind of wanted to be my own boss. Yeah, I'm very lucky, and so I get to travel the world hanging out with entrepreneurs and very rich people. It's a tough job, Rishi, but somebody's got to do it. And but it's almost essential for me. It's essential to just keep the energy going. Because, you know, running Angels Den has been really tough. We've run across some, you know, really tough times. And the whole point of being an entrepreneur, I think, is that you make mistakes. If you're not making mistakes, you're not doing it right. But you have to learn from it and get back up quickly again. And it's that energy that I get off on in terms of just meeting other entrepreneurs. You know, I'm a member of lots of entrepreneur clubs and right across the world. But here we're based in Adam Street, and I just love the energy that you can see out there. People are just discussing the problems, the opportunities, the excitement.
Yeah.
They're absolutely essential to be part of the community. Yeah, I mean, I think the biggest challenge in line with most people is convincing other people to give you money for it. You know, and I think the most difficult money that I've ever raised was friends and family. Because, you know, you're staring them in the eye, and if you lose that money, it's almost like 10 times worse than losing a stranger's money or an angel that you barely know.
Yeah.
The angel's moved into it, and his motivation is, you know, he knows what he's getting into. Friends and family will do it because they love you. And, you know, more often than I'd love to admit, you know, I've lost lots of friends and family money, and lots of friends. you know, so it's actually really difficult just raising money. And, you know, that's part of our motivation for actually setting it up. It is really, really difficult. The other thing, which is, I think this is part and parcel of it, but really difficult as well, is actually getting a team of like-minded people together. And, you know, it's you're either good at it or you're not. And often when you're younger as well, it's very difficult to know what you don't know. And thus, you know, it's difficult to know what skills to bring in, to buy in, and where to get these people. And once again, being part of a community or a website such as yours is just fantastic. You can actually be honest, you can be absolutely out there, and be congruent with your true self and see if people are attracted to it. Sure, I think it's to have a really clear idea of what it is, and I don't just mean being able to communicate it effectively. You have to have that vision, and you have to believe in it, and it has to be that passion. The guys that get funding will be able to communicate it, but will be able to communicate the energy that they want to do it. And then the understanding, the absolute understanding, that whatever you set off to do, you're going to get it wrong. Whatever your first business plan looks like, that is not what your business is going to end up like. And you have to have the tenacity, the energy to actually get up, dust yourself down and get on with it, having learned the lessons, and moving and pivoting forward in terms of that. So externally knowing what the marketplace is doing, externally understanding really what the drivers of the business are. And, you know, the one piece of advice for the younger entrepreneurs would be, really understanding what the impact is going to be to your client, to your customer, how you're going to impact on what it is that they do best, so you can actually sell that on to other people or become investors.
Brilliant. Thanks very much, Phil.
No, it's all right. It's been great. Well done.
Thanks.
Yeah.